my demise by the end of the year is grossly exaggerated. You'll have to wait one more year after the end of this year for this to happen. Excellencies, IDF, General Secretary, Executive Director, and members of the Advisory Board of Seafarers Rights International, permanent representatives to IMO, heads of international shipping organizations, Dr. Mensah, Mr. Schindler, distinguished guests and media representatives, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and happy Maritime Day. May seafarers, whose special day we celebrate today, always have fair winds and calm seas, and may they return safely home to their families and friends. It is my great pleasure to welcome you all to IMO headquarters today. You have been invited by our friends in the IDF to participate in the inauguration of Seafarers Rights International, and it is doubly fitting that we are able to host this auspicious occasion on their behalf. First, IMO has long been a committed supporter of seafarers. Their issues are always close to our hearts. Human element considerations in particular are constantly at the forefront of our collective minds in everything we do here at IMO. Second, and more specifically, as I have already said, today is, of course, World Maritime Day, and it cannot have escaped your attention that this year seafarers have been central to our team. Indeed, 2010 has been designated by IMO as the year of the seafarer. Our friends from the IDF and Seafarers Rights International will shortly give you details on what the center is, why it's been established, and how it will beneficially impact the lives of seafarers. Before they do so, I should like to take the opportunity to reiterate once again our reasons for dedicating 2010 to the seafarer. We wanted to give IMO, the maritime industries, and indeed the international community as a whole, the opportunity, first of all, to pay tribute to the world's seafarers for their unique contribution to society. In recognition of the risks they shoulder in the execution, far away from their families and friends, of their duties in what is often a hazardous and hostile environment. When 2010 was first proposed as the year of the seafarer, I remarked upon the particular hazards that confront the 1.5 million seafarers in the world, as well as the natural hazards of the sea and the elements, which they have to deal with as a matter of course. They also face, in our uncertain times, exceptional hazards, such as pirate attacks, unwarranted detention, and abandonment in foreign ports. The launch of Seafarers Rights International today will undoubtedly help those seafarers that are caught up in such circumstances through no fault of their own by providing a center dedicated to advancing seafarers' interests to research, education, and legal training concerning their seafarers' issues. Throughout this year, seafarer issues have had a particularly high profile in IMO's regulatory work, the pinnacle of which was, of course, the adoption in Manila last June of revisions to the International Convention on Standards of Training, Certification, and Watchkeeping for seafarers and its associated code. The Manila amendments, as they have become to be known, will ensure that the necessary global standards will be in place to train and certify certificates to operate today's technologically advanced ships for some time to come. Moreover, the designation by the Manila Conference of the 25th of June as the Day of the Seafarer, to be celebrated annually as from next year, will help to ensure that the vital role played by seafarers and the need to continually improve their safety and welfare remain uppermost in the consciousness of governments, shipping organizations, companies, owners, operators, and managers. In this context, it would be remiss of me not to mention and acknowledge the cooperation, deep and strong, IMO has long enjoyed with the International Labour Organization. Working in close collaboration on matters of common interest, and when the seriousness of a particular issue so dictates, through joint expert working groups, the two organizations, IMO and ILO, have developed guidelines on key issues such as the fair treatment of seafarers in the event of maritime accidents, and on liability and compensation regarding claims for death, personal injury, and abandonment of seafarers. This close cooperation with ILO is yet another indication of our belief that decent working and living conditions on board are indispensable if the human element is to be able to play its fundamental role in ensuring a safe, secure, efficient, and environmentally clean shipping industry. In this spirit, we've been keen to support the recent conventions adopted by ILO for both seafarers and fishers. The widespread ratification and effective implementation of the ILO Maritime Labour Convention, the Work and Fishing Convention, the Seafarers Identity Document are extremely important to securing the proper conditions for seafarers and fishers to render their services, and they are clearly complementary to the work of IMO. Indeed, the 2006 Maritime Labour Convention, in the development and adoption of which Monsieur Sinclair has played an instrumental role, and I'm so happy to see him with us today. That convention is widely recognized as the fourth pillar of international shipping regulation, alongside our IMO's conventions, such as SOLAS, MARPOL, and the STCW, dealing respectively with safety of life, environmental protection, and training matters. Finally, let me add that it was very much with seafarers in mind that we have decided that next year's World Maritime Day theme should be Piracy Orchestrating the Response, which will enable us all to redouble our focus on the modern scourge and how to orchestrate on a worldwide basis a decisive and effective response to this insidious challenge facing seafarers, fishers, passengers, and international shipping in the 21st century. Only 3 weeks ago, we had the opportunity to meet with Ambassador Fedotov, who until then was the representative, the ambassador of the Russian Federation here in London. And he has now been appointed by Ban Ki-moon as the head of the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime, the UNODC. And before he left to Vienna to take over his new responsibilities and duties, he came here so that we should continue the excellent cooperation we had with his predecessor, Antonio Costa, on matters of common interest, where IMO and UNODC interact. Our business is to prevent attacks by pirates. Their business is, once pirates have been arrested, to see that they are brought to justice and that they do not escape with impunity for their crimes. And only last week I met Jacques Lang, a former minister in the French government, who has been appointed by Mr. Ban Ki-moon as his special advisor on the legal aspects of piracy. We briefed him on what IMO does, and we started a good rapport and a good cooperation. But as far as I'm personally concerned, I consider that the pinnacle of my activities during this year, the year of the seafarer, was when in the margins of the Manila conference, I asked my friend, the labor minister, he was then a minister, he's not anymore, the labor minister in the Filipino government, to arrange for me to meet the wives and children of Filipino seafarers, who at the time were captive by pirates somewhere in Somalia. And he arranged it in 24 hours, which shows again how serious the Filipino government is in treating seafarers and looking after their well-being and their working conditions and safety on board ships. 24 hours after I told him that I would like to meet those ladies and their children, a meeting was arranged, and I spoke to them. It was one of the most emotional moments in my life, to meet these people who were looking at me. I explained to them that don't expect that I have the power to ensure the release of your loved ones. I wish I could, but I cannot, and I did not come here to promise this to you. But I came here to tell you that your pain is our pain. Your agony is our agony. Your anguish is our anguish. We share the very difficult days you are going through while your husbands and fiancés and boyfriends are in the hands of these criminal elements. And you could see their children with huge wide eyes looking at somebody who represents something, who however found the time to go and speak to their mothers and be with them. It was something I will always remember in my life. And so, ladies and gentlemen,